should know most of these, but in case you need the words, 177. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Let's stand together tonight. Let's lift our voice to the Lord. Good to be in church on Wednesday night. Let's sing it. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Trusting in His grace this hour, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Spotless are they. Settled. Do you know that? All right, 390 then. We'll go. You work on that one next week, all right? That's one of my favorite songs. 390. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Singing good tonight. Let's sing it out. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power. There's wonderful power in the blood. There's power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood. Power, power, wonder-working power. of you know that's true tonight. Amen. It was good enough to get us saved, wasn't it? Amen. Not just good enough to get you saved, it's good enough to keep you saved for all eternity. You can be seated tonight. Good to see you. Thank you, Brother Justin, again. You got some homework now. 176. Old account was settled. How many of you know that old song? I love that old song. Good one. Oh, it was a time on earth when in the book of heaven. Oh, I had a long list. Had a big and bad account. But thank God I settled out of court one day. Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to see you tonight. Thank you for understanding about our dinner. We moved it back to next Wednesday night because of some sickness. Miss Chris had to go to urgent care yesterday and it's not feeling up to par. So we just felt like we'd move it back a week and be in the clear. So thank everybody for understanding that. Do pray for Sister Chris and pray the Lord will touch her. It's that old stomach bug that's going around. And Miss Joan has it as well. In fact, I guess Miss Joan just loved her enough. She shared it with her from what I understand. As in Bible study last week, sitting together, and they both kind of come down with whatever's going around. So you pray for both those ladies tonight. If you would, please, don't forget in the morning, 10:30, Bible study. Brother Jerry's in the book of Hebrews and getting into, well, it's all good, but getting into that meaty part of the book of Hebrews. So I hope you'll be in your place in the morning at 10:30. And then Saturday morning, all the men at 9 o'clock, is our monthly prayer, Bible study, and fellowship together. And we'd love to have you if you don't normally come. We'd love to have you. If you do normally come, then you're expected to be there again. We always have a good time in the Lord. And then next Monday night, that'll be the 6th, I believe, is our monthly meeting down at the Mission, Atlantic City Baptist Mission. We'll go down there and leave about 6:15, 6:20. And pray for Brother Jerry. He'll be bringing the word down there Monday night. And pray the Lord to give us another good harvest of souls. Last year, we lost count. I know there was well over 100 trying to keep better count this year. And so far, we've had 24 men saved in January and February. And last year had well over 100. And we're praying again, God, to give us a good harvest of souls. We'll be taking our John and Romans down there, handing it out to all the men. Give them a little information after we leave. And so if you don't normally go, I know it would be a blessing to you. And if you do go, you could testify it is a blessing to go down there. And I pray the Lord will add his blessing to the work that is done for him tonight. Do remember, as I said, Chris and Miss Joan, Bernie and Sherry, continue to remember them. Miss Elizabeth, she's down in Jacksonville this week, down to Mayo Clinic, and getting some consultation done on the steps ahead of her as far as surgery and all that that will involve. So she'll be back on Friday, and you remember her in prayer as she travels home. And remember Brother Terry Douglas, he has been having some trouble a few days ago, some chest pains and such, so you remember him. He's got an appointment, I believe it's the end of the week, and with his heart doctor, so remember him in prayer as well. The Lord will give them wisdom what to do. And then Dana Fallbush, I don't know if you know the name or not, but sits with Miss Carol Tucker, and the young family there has the little boy, and he was involved in a very bad car wreck here about a week ago. Talked to him today. He's got 3 compressed discs in the lower part of his back and in a lot of pain, and wife and little boy are good, but he's just in a lot of pain, and he's going to be seeing a surgeon here in the next few days. So remember him in prayer tonight. He's surely had a lot to deal with, and he's had COVID, pneumonia, all kinds of other problems in this. And so remember him in prayer tonight. I know he would appreciate it. Anybody else have a need of prayer tonight that we need to remember? All right. Remember Sister. All right. Miss Angie Mills. Remember her. And Miss Carol, remember Miss Carol and Miss Angie Mills. Sister Robin? Okay. Sure. Amen. That is the truth. If you don't believe that, y'all try it sometime. Amen. In fact, the Bible says, God says, prove me. He said, it's the only time God dares you in the Bible. Prove me. We'd say up home, I double dog dare you. Now, if you ever double dog dare somebody, you have to do it. You know, you're not a man. You need to turn your man card in if you don't take somebody up on a double dog dare. It's like Tony Hudson says, if you drink milk with a blue lid, you need to turn your man card in. Amen. But God said, prove me. Put me to the test and see if I want to open the windows of heaven. And God knows how to get it back to us, doesn't he? Amen. He's been good to all of us tonight. Anybody else have a need of prayer, a word of praise for the Lord? Remember Fred and Wendy, I guess they're still, every time I wake up, I know the rapture ain't hit, I'm still here. So I guess they're still in Florida. I don't know when they're coming back, but remember them in prayer. And pray the Lord to give them a good time down there. Anybody else tonight have a need of prayer? Any unspoken requests tonight? By the uplifted hand, the Lord knows all about those tonight, and I sure am glad that he does. Remember our missionaries, I'll read them off real quick and mention the Brown family to Turkey, of course, Calvary Children's Home, Coker family to China, Shoemates with the Rock of Ages, the Loonies to Indonesia, they're on the field now, the Dye family to Uganda, Brother David Epps, the Pontius family to Mexico, they'll be on the field next month. The Croker family to Bolivia, they're on the field now as well. And the Sears family to Iceland. The Brown family, missionaries to Turkey. You know, a few weeks ago, those earthquakes hit that region over there and really devastated that whole area. And it's really kind of knocked them for a loop because of the government and the mandates on their visas and all the credentials that they need to get into the country. And so the government pretty much has put everything on lockdown, not letting anybody in or out until they start a cleanup process over there. So they're just kind of in limbo right now, wanting to be there, but just not able to by the means of the government. So you pray for Brother Dustin and his family that the Lord will get them back there as soon as possible, and they can pick back up on the work. They had just found a building and just started the first independent Baptist church there forget the capital city there, but just outside that capital city. And then that earthquake hit and just shut everything down. So remember them tonight. Remember the people that they would be ministering to. They need a shepherd tonight, and they're not able to be there. So remember the Brown family that are going to Turkey, all right? Seemed like I missed something, but I'm sure somebody will remind me if I don't remember myself. But seemed like I'm missing something, but Lord knows what it is. Anybody have anything else tonight? We need to remember in prayer. Yes, sir. Okay. Remember Sister Patsy in prayer. Okay. He getting on your nerves, so you got to get it blocked, don't you? Amen. Yeah, Miss Kim knows all about that too. Amen. Amen. Miss BJ's probably had a few of them too, ain't she? Amen. Amen. I asked Kim yesterday, this morning, I said, what day is it? She said, March the 1st. March 1st. So I got up, walked around the room, said, okay, what's the date? You'll get that after a while. Some of y'all real slow tonight. You've had a long, hard day. March 1st, I marched around the room. Well, it went over good, didn't it? Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, anybody else have a need of prayer tonight? Word of testimony? Word of praise. If you're glad you're in church on Wednesday night, say amen. Amen. Good to be here. Appreciate the goodness of the Lord. He's been good to us. We've been having some good services around here. I'm thankful for that. Appreciate that. Saw the pulpit all turned around up here. I thought Barry Spears has been up here. I don't know if you know Brother Barry or not, but he's got a reputation for climbing on pulpits while he's preaching and let the pulpit all turned around. And I've even seen him headbutt Kleenex boxes when he gets in the Holy Ghost. Amen. So I thought, man, something's going on. Either Barry Spears or Marty Few's been up here, and they've messed it. Anybody know those names? Marty Few, old Brother Marty, Homer, Louisiana. Old brother, you never been in a meeting, Brother Marty, you ain't lived, I'm telling you. 88? Probably close to 90. We was in camp meeting up in Taylorsville a few years ago, and I mean it got on. I'm telling you, this old camp getting his sawdust shavings on the ground, big tabernacle. And I seen them swinging off the beams. They jumping up, swinging off the beams and shouting. It's real, too. It wasn't fake. It's real. And old Brother Marty, he took off a running and he slid in them sawdust shavings. And he slid right there and just fell. And everybody thought, Lord, he's old. He probably broke something. People trying to go help him up. He's saying, leave me alone. Let me shout in the sawdust. And he's doing snow angels in the sawdust, just having a time. That's Marty Few right there. He's one of a kind. Praise the Lord. I love them old men of God, them old generals of the faith. They're most of them done slipping off now, crossing over. Generation coming behind us. Don't know anything about the God and the glory that they knew. And boy, that's heartbreaking, isn't it? But as long as I have breath, I'm going to do all I can to try to carry the torch. Amen. I've been around it too much to know if you ever get a taste of it, you want some more of it. Amen. So I'm thankful for the goodness of the Lord. Amen. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Let's ask His blessing upon all these names, upon all these needs tonight. And remember our young people upstairs, our children, and all that work with them. Pray the Lord will give them exactly what they need tonight. And let's ask the Lord to have His will and His way in our service together tonight. Brother Richard, if you don't mind, won't you stand and take us to the throne of grace and ask the Lord's will on these names tonight. Please, sir, thank you. And all God's people said, amen. Take your Bible tonight, be finding the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 2. Mark, chapter number 2. I mentioned Sunday about Barnabas when we looked at Paul, how they tried to kill him, but Barnabas took him. Of course, Paul owed Barnabas a debt. The Lord used Barnabas to help save Paul's life. But there's another man that owed Barnabas a debt, and that would be the man whose gospel we're looking at tonight, and that is John Mark. He left Paul and those on that missionary journey, so when it come time around again to go, Paul didn't want to take him, but Barnabas took him with him. And had it not been for Barnabas, we likely would not have this second gospel tonight. Thank God for people like Barnabas that are encouragers, people that they help strengthen the brethren and help encourage them along in the faith. But in Mark chapter 2 tonight, if I was going to title this little thought tonight, I would preach on this subject, a church that raises the roof. Because as you read these first 12, 13 verses of Mark chapter number 2, that's exactly what's taking place. I mean, the Lord Jesus showed up. It wasn't even a church. It was just a house. Most believe it was the house and the home of Simon Peter. In verse number 1, but it got noised abroad that he, that's Jesus, was in the house. He comes back to his headquarters, Capernaum, and there he begins his public earthly ministry, and he's preaching the word of God. And some amazing things happen in the following verses as Jesus is beginning to do what only he alone can do. There was a time of saturation. The presence of God was in the house. It was noised abroad that he was in the house. And straightway, immediately, people just began to gather. Word got out that Jesus was there. And again, it wasn't a church building. They didn't have a steeple. They didn't have stained glass windows. It was just a common, ordinary home. But I remind you tonight, when Jesus shows up, he takes something that's common, and all of a sudden he turns it into something that's uncommon. He turns a dwelling place into a divine place. And by the way, he's still looking for a place. He's standing at the door of the church and he's knocking. And whoever hears his voice and open the door, he says, I'll come in and I'll sup with them and they can sup with me. He's still looking for a place that will let him saturate that place with his wonderful and glorious presence. So there was saturation by the presence of God. Then there was participation by the people of God. We'll look at that more here in a minute. But there was four fellas that got involved. They saw a need, and they got involved in the need that they saw and how God met that need because of their participation. Somebody said one time that the average church, Baptist church, is a lot like a football game. You've got on a football game, you've got all these 11 men on the field, and you've got thousands in the bleachers. And the average church is like that. You've got a few on the field, and there's a lot of people that are sitting in the sidelines in the grandstand watching everything go on. This isn't a place, a spectator sport. This is a place where we've been called to get involved. We've been called to serve. And when there is a need, we've been called to do everything we can do to try to help meet that need for the glory of God and for the good of our brother and of our sister. What a wonderful place it would be if there was total participation in the house of God. I mean, if all the singers would sing, and if all the teachers would teach, and if all the preachers would preach, and if all the greeters would greet, and if all the servants would serve, and everybody would find their place and participate, what a wonderful place that would be. I read one time, I don't know how true that it is, but I read one time that in the average church, you've got 20% of the people that does 80% of the work and gives 80% of the money. I don't know how true that is, but I would dare say, even if you bump that up, what a wonderful place it would be if it went from 20% to 50%, maybe to 60% of people that got involved and did what God had given them to do in the service of the ministry of the local church. That's what happens here. There was participation by the people of God. But as you go down to the latter part of the text in verse 9 through verse 12, you not only see saturation by the presence of God and participation by the people of God, but there's celebration for the power of God. I mean, they are amazed at what Jesus did in this wonderful, mighty miracle that takes place. And I'm intrigued in verse number 2. You know how Jesus began his earthly ministry? It wasn't by opening blinded eyes. It wasn't by unstopping deaf ears. It wasn't by loosening dumb tongues. It wasn't by healing crippled legs. It wasn't even by raising the dead back to life. You know how Jesus began his earthly ministry? Verse 2 tells us that he preached the word unto them. Now I want you to get a picture of that. He who is the word is preaching the word. He who in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. He who is the living word of God is preaching unto them the written word of God. Man, wouldn't you like to have been taking notes on that message in that house? Wouldn't you like to have been taking some notes on that lesson? The one who is the word is preaching and teaching the word into the hearers, into the hearts of those that are gathered there that day. That's how he began his earthly ministry. That just reminds me of the importance of the preaching of the word of God. You know what God has chose in this dispensation and time to save people? It's not a movie, and it's not some movement, and it's not some great grandstand, but God has chose the preaching of the cross. To them that perish, it is foolishness, but to us which are saved, it is the power of God. Thank God for preachers. Thank God for preaching. There is no substitute. There is no shortcut. There is no replacement. We don't need less preaching today. We need more preaching today. We don't need less preachers today. We need more God-called men with a backbone like a saw log that will preach without fear and without favor what thus saith the Lord. And if it was good enough for Jesus to preach the word, I believe it's still good enough tonight for us to preach the word. Can I get an amen? There's saturation of the presence of God. There's participation by the people of God. There's celebration of the power of God. But I want to focus in tonight on verse number 3, 4, and 5. All that was introduction. Here's what I want to get to tonight. You'll have this simple little thought and we'll go home. The Bible said in verse number 3, we'll look at verse number 2. And they came unto him bringing one sick, or verse 3, one of the palsy which is born of 4. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Amazing need now is being met as these 4 men, we don't know who they are. We're not given their name. We don't know their background. We don't know where they're from. All that we know is that these 4 men saw the need of another man that could not help himself. He could not get himself to Jesus. And these men got involved in the life and in the need to try to meet the need of this other man. And the Bible said Jesus saw their faith. Well, what kind of faith was it? Well, verse 3, I believe we could say tonight it was compassionate faith. You see that word there, which was born of 4? That word born there means to sympathize. That word born there means to share. In other words, when they saw this man's need, they were moved to compassion to the point to where his need became their very own need. And they got involved in this man's life and in this man's situation, and they began to share and to shoulder that need, and they had enough compassion about them to try to help somebody that could not help themselves. Have not we been called in Galatians 6:2 to bear ye one another's burdens and to so fulfill the law of Christ? Have we not been called to have compassion? And Jude says those are the only people that make a difference in our world. Our problem today is we're not moved anymore. We're not stirred anymore. Our tear ducts have dried up. Our hearts have not been broken in a long time about those that are perishing and lost without God, and those that have a need in their life, and they need somebody that knows how to pray through, and somebody that knows how to get a hold of God, and somebody that knows how to ring those prayer bells of glory. When they can't even pray for themselves, they need somebody to intercede on their behalf and to take their name before God. And somebody's got to have enough compassion and enough sympathy and care enough to want to get involved in the life of somebody else to try to get them before Jesus, because they know if they can ever get to Jesus, Jesus can fix whatever's wrong and he can make it right. Here's what thought hit me the other morning when I considered their faith. You may not be able to talk to your family about the Lord, but nobody can stop you from talking to the Lord about your family. You may not be able to get them to Jesus, but they can't stop you from taking Jesus to them. It's compassion. And I remember not too long ago, people used to care. People used to be moved. When sinners were in a service and you give an invitation, they'd even raise their hand and acknowledge that they're lost, but they're not moved, and there'd be no stirring. Boy, that used to break people's hearts. Still breaks my heart, bothers me greatly, man. It keeps me up at night knowing there are lost people here, not right with God, those that are away from God. It ought to be that there's such an environment that anybody that walks through these doors, they may walk in not right with God, but they can walk out right with God and on their way to heaven. Somebody's got to have some compassion. It takes compassion to take a gospel tract out of your pocket and leave it on the dinner of a restaurant that you go to. It takes compassion to give a tract to somebody in person. It takes compassion to leave it in a store, leave it at a gas station, wherever. It takes some compassion to care enough about somebody's eternal soul that you do something that might get you out of your own little comfort zone. But aren't you glad for the day somebody come across the street and talk to you about Jesus? It was compassionate faith. He saw their faith. They shared. They bore this man's need. They bore this man's burden to the point that they got involved in this man's situation. It was compassionate faith. Then I would say a word tonight in verse number 4 that it was not only compassionate faith, but it was costly faith. What do you mean, preacher? Look at verse 4. When they could not come nigh unto Jesus for the press, the crowd is so great they couldn't get to him. They couldn't get through the normal door of the home. So what did they do? They uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. You say, preacher, how is that costly faith? Here's my question. Who paid for the roof? I mean, they climbed on top of the house, and I don't know if there were shingles. I don't know if it was a mud hut. I don't know, but there was a roof, and in order to get him to Jesus, they had to tear up the roof. I doubt very seriously. Many believe this was the home of Simon Peter. I doubt very seriously Simon Peter had homeowner's insurance. I doubt very seriously he couldn't call the government and qualify for some FEMA relief. Somebody had to pay for the roof damage. I just believe Jesus probably took care of that need just like he took care of this need. But somebody had to be willing to pay the price no matter what the cost. I doubt very seriously them old boys are thinking about, boy, this is going to cost us an arm and a leg. Man, we're tearing Jack up on this roof, and I'm going to tell you, it's going to cost me my paycheck. I doubt very seriously these old boys had ever entered their mind. Why? Because they were willing to pay the price. They had a friend that needed a touch, and they couldn't get to Jesus a normal way, so they got to Jesus an abnormal way, and Jesus saw their compassionate and their costly faith. It's been well said, if your faith doesn't cost you much, it's not worth much. What's your faith cost you lately? Has it cost you maybe some ridicule? People made fun of you? Oh, you one of them Jesus freaks. Hallelujah. You ought to shake their hand, hug their neck, thank them. That's one of the greatest compliments somebody could ever give you. Somebody told me one night, Wagers, you're nuts. I said, hallelujah, you doggone right, but I'm screwed on the right boat. Can I get an amen right there? Amen. It ought to cost you something. Jesus said, rejoice when men revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil falsely against you for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for so persecuted they the prophets that were before. It ought to cost us something to serve God. It ought to cost us something to share the gospel with somebody. It was compassionate faith. They bore this man. It was costly faith. But then I say, it was courageous faith. Look at verse 5. Jesus saw their faith. All right, now here's a question. First question is, whose faith? It wasn't the faith of the man laying on the bed because he couldn't help himself. He couldn't get himself. He couldn't climb himself up on the roof, tear the shingles up, lower himself down. So it couldn't have been his faith. But Jesus saw their faith. Whose faith? Whose faith was it that he saw? The four men. Now here's question 2. I thought the Bible said now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Everybody all right? But the Bible says Jesus saw their faith. Faith that is unseen, Jesus saw their faith. It got his attention. It captured him. He's moved by what he saw. He saw their faith. Now the Bible said, James said, faith without works is dead. Is that not what he said? Is that not what James said? Faith without works is dead. Is everybody all right tonight? This isn't deep, this isn't hard. So you can nod your head, you can say amen. Faith without works is dead. He said, you show me your faith and I'll show you my works with my faith. It's not faith plus works. It's not faith and works, but it's faith that works. You're not saved by faith plus works. You're not saved by faith and works. But if you're saved and it's a saving faith, it will be a faith that works. There will be evidence in your life to give proof to the fact that what you say you have on the inside is proven by what shows up on the outside. And Jesus saw their faith. I want to ask you, all of us, a question tonight. Can anybody see your faith? Y'all get quiet on me, so I know I must be hitting something. I can hear my daddy up in heaven tonight from 50 years ago, coon hunting as a little boy in the hollers in the hills of eastern Kentucky. And we'd be shooting. I couldn't see him up there, but I knew I was hitting something because I could hear the thud. And daddy'd shine a light up there, and he'd say, "Keep a shooting, boy. He'll come down after a while." I can hear him tonight. "Keep a shooting, preacher boy, because they'll come after a while." Amen. Can anybody see our faith? They ought to be able to see something. I think about a blind and a deaf man. He went to church every time the doors were open. I mean, faithful as clockwork. Went to Sunday school, went to preaching, went back on Sunday night, Wednesday night, by any time anything was going on at the house of God. That blind and deaf man was found in his place. Somebody asked him one day, said, "Why in the world do you go to church? You can't see anything. You can't hear anything. You have no clue what's going on. Why in the world do you go to church?" He said, "That's simple. I want everybody to know whose side I'm on." How can people see our faith? Well, they see our faith when we go to church. Your neighbors ought to see your faith. They ought to know Sunday's not the day that we go down to the lake. Sunday's the day we go to the house of God. So I told me one time, Brother Richard, he'd always go down to fish, and he bought a big boat, and he'd go down there, and he told me, he said, "Now, preacher, I can pull my boat, and I can go down to that lake, and I can worship God on the waters of that lake and enjoy all of his wonderful creation, and I can worship God down there just as easy as you can worship him in church." I said, "Sir, that might be true, but the only problem is when people see you pulling that boat behind your truck, they don't assume you're going to church. They assume you're going to the lake. Somebody ought to know that Sunday is the Lord's day, and they ought to see our faith in action every single time. They ought to see our faith when we tell people about Jesus. They ought to see our faith trying to help a brother, sister, neighbor, somebody, friend. Who is my neighbor? They ask Jesus that question, trying to trick him. They're thinking, "Well, my neighbor's next door." And Jesus said, no, that's not your neighbor. Look out. Here's your neighbors. Anybody that Jesus loves, we ought to love, and they're our neighbor. And people see our faith. It's an action. It's an active faith. It's a moving faith. It is a stirring faith. It's when we step out and we do whatever God has called and commanded us to do, that's when people can see our faith. We need some courageous faith in these days and in these hours. Listen to me. We don't need any more undercover Secret Service Christians. We've got enough of them. Churches are full of them. We need somebody with some boldness that'll say, "I don't care what it costs me. I don't care what they say about me. I don't care if they never invite me back to the family reunion." Because when they ask you to pray and you get a chance, you're going to let it rip. "I don't care what it costs me, but I'm going to stand for Jesus. And I'm going to let everybody be known I'm not ashamed of him, because I don't want him to be ashamed of me." It was a courageous faith, a captivating faith. Jesus saw. Here he is, all the activity going around. The roof is being tore. The bed's being lowered down to the ground. And Jesus, in the midst of all the activity, he sees their faith. Man, what a thought that Jesus might take notice of our faith. That Jesus might take notice of the life that we live and the compassion that we have and the burden that we share, that our Lord might take notice of it and see captivates him. It intrigues him as he looks and he sees our faith. Well, what happened? Well, you know the rest of the story. Because they got that old boy to Jesus, Jesus, he forgave him spiritually in verse number 9. He come down to verse 9 and he told the man, he said, whether it's easy to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or say, rise, take up thy bed and walk. That's in response to that religious crowd, because not everybody was happy about what took place. I can just see that religious crowd, that finance committee, they probably called a meeting and said, now we're going to have a special call, because somebody's going to have to pay for this damage. We didn't factor this into our budget, and so this is an unforeseen. And that religious crowd, their nerves are shot. They're tore to pieces. They're not even paying attention to what's really taking place. Their eyes are upon stuff that don't matter, stuff that are temporary. And so Jesus says to them, what do you think is easier, for me to forgive this man or to tell him, rise, take up thy bed and walk? And Jesus forgave that man. By the way, that was his greatest need. His greatest need was not to be healed physically. What good would it have done, Brother Richard, if Jesus would have healed him physically but not forgiven him spiritually? If he would have just healed him physically, he'd have died and still went to hell. But his greatest need was a spiritual need. And Jesus forgave him spiritually. By the way, that's still the greatest need tonight. Greatest miracle that's ever taken place is not dead people being brought back to life, blind eyes open, crippled legs walk, dumb tongues to be loosened, deaf ears to be that's not none of those great miracles, but none of the greatest. I tell you, the greatest miracle is the day you couldn't get to God, but God came to wherever you were and he picked you up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set your feet on a rock, and he took your black heart and he washed it in red blood, and he made it white as snow, wrote your name down in heaven, made you a brand new creature in Christ, forgave all your sins, past, present, and prospective. That is still the greatest miracle that's ever taken place. So he forgave him spiritually. And then he fixed him physically. The Bible said, I say, verse 11, arise, take up thy bed, go thy way into thine house. And immediately, I love that word. Mark is great. He'll either use the word immediately or the word straightway. They're interchangeable. They both mean the same thing. Immediately, without delay, he arose and took up the bed and went forth before them all. What a miracle. It would have never happened if somebody didn't have enough of a burden and enough of compassion to try to get this man to Jesus who could not get himself to Jesus. None of these verses would have ever been penned had it not been for those four men and their compassionate faith, their costly faith, and their courageous faith that Jesus took notice of. This man got what he needed from the Lord. He came to church that day with his head on the bed, but he went home that day with his bed on his head. I'll say it again because some of y'all are a little slow. He came in with his head on the bed, but he went home with his bed on his head. Forgiven spiritually, fixed physically, and don't you just think, we don't know anything else about this fellow. We don't know his name. We don't know where he's from. After Mark 2, he fades off the page of the Word of God. But I just can't help but believe, Brother Jimmy, that this old boy, after what Jesus had done for him, maybe a few weeks later, he saw somebody that had a need. Don't you think this old boy remembered? Man, I remember there was a day I couldn't get to Jesus, and I'm thankful them old boys got me to Jesus. They helped me when I couldn't help myself. Somebody else got a need. I'm going to try to help somebody else that can't help themselves. He's just passing it on because of what the Lord had done for him. And Jesus saw their faith. And look how they went home that day, verse 12. They were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw it on this fashion. They went home that day, and this is what they said, Brother Avery, we've never seen anything like that before. We've been going to church a long time. We've never seen it like that. We've never, in all our lifelong days we have never experienced. It wasn't just the roof being tore up. It wasn't just Jesus in the house, crowd gathered around. It wasn't just this old boy being lowered down and then being raised and forgiven and fixed. It wasn't him walking out when he couldn't walk in. But I believe it was the power and the presence of God that they said, we've never seen anything like that before in all of our life. Greatest thing anybody could ever say about New Genesis Baptist Church. When they come in here and visit, where they visit, where they're regular, it shouldn't be, boy, what a preacher, what a message, what a song, what a singer, what a friend. They ought to leave and say, you know what, we've been to a lot of churches, but we ain't ever seen anything like that before. We ain't ever seen God move like that. We ain't ever seen the power of the Holy Ghost work and move and people coming to an altar and people getting right with God and getting set free, getting saved. They ought to leave and get in their car and say, we ain't never seen nothing like that in our life. We ought to put that on our sign. Come to a place you ain't ever seen it like that before. Amen. Because that's what happens when Jesus gets in the house. He takes over. He does what only he can do, what nobody else can do. You put him in a box, and which a lot of people do, but you can't keep him in a box. He's going to have his will and his way. He's going to find a place that lets him be Lord of all. If it's not this place, then he'll go down the road. He'll find a place. But he'll find a place, he'll find a people that are more interested in his presence and in his power than in anything else. And when he shows up and he gets in the house, that's where lives are changed. That's where needs are met. That's where burdens are lifted. That's where souls are saved, when Jesus gets in the house. And it's all because of the faith of these four men. Jesus saw it, took notice of it. And that old boy got what he could not and would not have got any other way. He got what he needed from the Lord. I wonder if anybody will ever benefit from our faith. We probably won't know the full realm of it till we get to heaven. But it'd be good as we live this old life down here that we just don't live selfishly all to ourselves, about ourselves, for ourselves. But it'd be good that along the journey somebody benefits from our faith. Somebody benefits from our testimony, from our love for the Lord, from our service to the Lord. That somebody would benefit and be blessed. And maybe when they're under a load and maybe they're discouraged, maybe that would be when they don't even have the faith to muster up, maybe that it could be the faith of a child, seasoned child of God that could come alongside of them. And when they're down, lift them up. When they're discouraged, give them a word of encouragement. When they need help, try to help them up and hunt them up and try to get them to Jesus. May somebody benefit and be blessed from our faith. God's been too good to us for us just to keep it to ourselves. If God's been good to you, you ought to pay it forward to somebody else. Be a blessing to them. A little funny story, but I was in a drive-thru, oh, it's been a few weeks ago. Lady behind me was irate. I don't know, guess she was having a bad day. And so she told me I was number one, but with the wrong finger. If you understand what that means. I don't know how to be, but without being any more graphic, you know what I'm talking about. So I got to the drive-thru and I said, I want to pay for that lady's meal behind me. I don't know what she's got. I'm thinking under my board, dear God, I hope she didn't buy the family feast. Amen. Praise the Lord. But whatever she got, she gave me the total. And I said, then when you let her know, don't tell her who it was, whatever. And I gave her a gospel tract. I said, would you give this to her? And so I pulled off and I pulled up far enough where she couldn't see. I kind of pulled around to where I could see what was going on. And she got to the window and the lady at the drive-thru told her, somebody's already paid for your meal. And then I could see her pointing. I don't know what she was saying, but I could see her pointing. Then I could see her give her that big bag of food, and then her her drinks and then give her that gospel tract. I don't say that to brag and boast tonight. I'm just saying I didn't know that lady from Adam, but I know this, God loved her just as much as he loved me. Ain't no telling what was going on in her life. She may have had a bad day. Who knows? She may have come from a broken home. I don't know, but I know behind me I could tell she was having a bad day. Now, I'm telling you tonight, there's all kinds of people out here. You don't have to go looking long and hard to find them. There's people out here that are hurting. They need to know that somebody has enough real deal Christianity, not just to talk about it on Sunday, but to live it out on Monday and every day of the week. It's easy to come in here and talk about how much we love God. That's easy when you're around like-minded believers. The real test comes when you go home and you work for a boss that cusses you up one side and down the other. And then to smile and try to show and share the love of Jesus. That's where the real test comes in. But somebody's looking. They've seen enough fakes and they've seen enough phonies. Somebody's looking for something that's real. That the love of God shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. Because when Jesus sees that kind of faith in action, that's when business starts to pick up. And people can get the help that they need. And wouldn't it be good to get to heaven and find out that somebody got to Jesus because of your faith? You either prayed them in, you helped them up, whatever, but you stepped up and met a need that they could not have done on their own. Jesus saw their faith. An old story years ago about an old Chinese doctor. He learned finally how to cure the blindness of the plague that had just covered the country there. He did a lot of research, went to school, spent a lot of money, and finally believed that he had uncovered and unlocked something that before had never been discovered. A man came to him, he explained to him the procedure, said, "Sir, it's very risky. I cannot guarantee you 100% that it'll work. But I'll do my best. I'll give you the best care that I can. Use the best knowledge, techniques that I know how." And the man said, "I'm willing to do whatever it takes." The man performed the surgery many, many hours. Finally, after a few days of recovery, they took the bandages off. And for the first time since that man was a little boy, he opened his eyes and he could see. He saw the colors as his eyes began to get adjusted. He saw the vivid imagery that he had missed out on for all those years. That Chinese doctor told him, he said, "Now, I would rather you not advertise this." He said, "It's a new procedure. It's more experimental than anything, so I would rather that you not go tell everybody about it." But a couple days later, that old doctor got to his office. And he heard a commotion outside of his door, and he looked down from the window, and he saw a line of Chinese blind people that was lined up to get into his office door. He couldn't turn them away. He explained to them the same risk and the same no guarantees as he did to the first man. But he went and found that first man, and he said, I thought that I told you. He said, "Doc, I couldn't help myself." He said, "I couldn't explain what you did because I don't know medicine. I don't know surgery. I don't know the ophthalmology of the eye. I couldn't tell anybody how all that worked. But all I could tell them is I once was blind, but now I see." And they wanted to come meet the same doctor that had done for me what they needed him to do for them. Doesn't that sound a lot like salvation? You may not be able to explain Bible doctrine. You may not be able to get into the great mysteries of the faith. But you can leave this place tonight and go tell people, "I once was blind, but now I see. I met a doctor one day. He took my case. With or without insurance, he's never met a patient that he wouldn't see, a problem that he couldn't solve, a prescription that he couldn't supply. Let me tell you about this doctor. He's never met a case that he couldn't take care of." And Jesus saw their faith. Man, I pray this week when we leave this place, I not only pray the Lord will see our faith, But I pray somebody else will see our faith. At work, at school, at home, in the neighborhood, they will see our faith in action. And God will get glory. And when we come here Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday, every time we gather together, may we welcome the presence of God and the power of God. We shouldn't be strangers to that. Man, we ought to welcome it. Roll out the welcome mat for Him every time and say, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. And let God just do the work that only God alone could do. Brother Jerry, if I had the power to do it, I'd do it, but I don't. You don't either. None of us do. But I know a man who can. I know a man one day that did it for me. And I know if he could do it for me, he can do it for anybody. And not only saved me, but he's kept me saved. He sustained me. Gives me power when we're tempted. He gives you power. It's not willpower. It's word power. It's a word of the Lord Jesus working in you and through you. You didn't have that power before, but now that power is on the inside. Oh, what a difference he makes in our lives. And we ought to tell somebody what Jesus has done for us. He saw their faith. A church that raises the roof. They raised the roof that day, didn't they? They sure did in more ways than one. Man, we ought to be a place that raises the roof for the glory of God. This ought to be the most exciting place in town. And I ain't talking about working it up and putting it on. But if the Spirit of God lives in you and we come to the house of God, we're not here for a funeral. We're here for a resurrection. My Bible says God is not a God of the dead. He's a God of the living. He's alive. We ought to act like we're alive. Amen. And if for nothing else, celebrating the fact that you once were blind, but now you see by the power and the presence of the Lord. And all God's people said amen. Praise the Lord. Well, all hearts and minds clear tonight. If you appreciate the Word of God, aren't you thankful we have this old Bible tonight? We can learn, grow. Praise the Lord. Lord willing, Sunday morning, we're going to begin a journey that will lead to Easter. We're going to look at the old rugged cross. We're going to look at the crowd around the cross Sunday morning. There's a host, a cast of characters that all played a part. Leading up to the events of the cross. We're going to look at all of them in a kind of a summary. We're going to look at those that blasphemed him, those that belittled him, those that betrayed him, and then those that believed him. And then next Sunday we'll move from the crowd around the cross to the cries from the cross. Seven cries, three that he made to God, four that he made to man. Seven cries that Jesus uttered, his last dying words. Then the next Sunday, I believe that'd be the 19th, we'll go from the crowd around the cross to the cries from the cross, and we'll look at the Christ on the cross, John 19. And we'll see John, the only eyewitness account. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they weren't there, but John was there. And they wrote secondhand information based on what they heard, but John saw it all. He saw everything from the beginning all the way to the cross, the resurrection. And John saw him coming out of that judgment hall bearing his own cross to the place of the skull. And then we'll look at, I believe that's the last Sunday, the crowd around the cross, the cries from the cross, the Christ on the cross. Then we'll go to the calendar after the cross. And we'll look now that he's died. They put him in that tomb and the 3 days that took place. Paul talks about in Ephesians 4. Day one, he descended. Day two, he ascended. Day three, he transcended, he come out. And then we'll look at the last Sunday on the cemetery beyond the cross. He is not here, he is risen. And he not only got out of a hole, and he not only went back to heaven, but one day he came and lived in my heart. Thank God. What a Savior, hallelujah. So you pray for us, looking forward to preaching on that crowd around the cross, gathered around there. On Sunday morning, you pray the Lord will help us. And Sunday night will be our first Sunday communion that we do the first Sunday night of every month. So it'll be always a sweet time together. Pray one for another. You see a need, help meet the need. Everybody can talk about it, but it takes somebody with some Christ-like compassion to get involved and to go across the street and to pick up that old wounded fella, try to help meet his needs. I pray God will help us be those kind of Christians tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. In the morning, 10:30. 9 o'clock Saturday morning, men. Hope you'll be in your place. Anything else before we leave? Before we go home tonight? 9 o'clock Saturday morning. Yes, sir. Anything else? Everybody good? Pray for revival. Yes, sir. Pray for revival. Times of refreshing come from the presence of the Lord. Amen. I found an old sermon. I ain't preached it here yet. I was looking for some notes the other day, and I come across an old sermon. I first preached it in 1998. I preached it again, I think, 04, 07, 08. It's been several years. And I don't know if y'all are ready for it yet, but Ezekiel chapter number 37. And I preach on Welcome to Dry Bones Baptist Church. With them old dead dry bones in the valley, God asked Ezekiel, can they live again? And Ezekiel said, Lord, only you know. Only you know. But you know what caused them to live again? It was the breath of God. God's breath. He moved. Ezekiel preached. God told him, son of man, prophesy. And he preached unto them bones. And as he preached, the Spirit of God, the breath of heaven began to move. And all of a sudden, the ankle bone connected to the thigh bone, and the thigh bone connected to the shin bone, and the shin bone connected to the hip bone. And all of a sudden, them bones in the valley lived again. But it took the preaching of the word and the Spirit of God. And that's still what it takes to have revival today. So we need to pray that God would revive our own hearts and then let it spread. Let it spread. All right, all hearts and minds clear. You glad you come? Say amen. Amen. Let's stand together tonight. Next Wednesday night, Lord willing, we'll gather for our fellowship meal. 5:30 we'll start. We'll go give everybody plenty of time to get here and eat a bite. And appreciate you understanding having to reschedule that. But that'll be next Wednesday night. Then Lord willing, the following week, we're going to start verse by verse through the longest chapter in the Bible, Psalm 119. It's all about the Word of God, truth of the Word. We'll believe about 22 messages because it's a division of 8 verses a section and 176 verses, so we'll look at one each week, but it'll be a good study. Hope you'll pray for us. All right, let's be dismissed in a word, good word of prayer tonight. Thank you for being here. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto thee, and lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Pray you have a good night, good rest of your week, all right? Brother Jerry, won't you dismiss us?